Okay, very good. Well, I see that I'm the last presentation of the day. Guess everybody's had enough of this and ready to go home. I'll be short. Everybody knows I don't do very much anyway. So, let's first, a lot of these slides you may have seen before, but I left them in here just in case, you know, there's a new people or somebody doesn't remember things or whatever. But ACPI is usually the first thing I go over because it's such an important part of what makes our system work. I know it's not a big thing in the news anymore, but it's still really important. It's the PSD is really what makes our system still work today. In fact, it used to be that, you know, you might decide whether or not you're going to use the PSD because sometimes it would cause problems or you weren't sure it was really a benefit. But today, things are a lot different. Now, if you're not using the PSD, you're probably having problems and your system is not running up to its full potential. Even using switches like /VW means your system is running degraded and potentially has problems. Things are just not the way they used to be anymore. Anyway, this is what the ACPI driver project is. It kind of gives you a block diagram of what's presented. I assume everybody can see my slides, right? Basically, the driver project is this section right here, where the PSD is the most important part of it, and then there's other support things that go along with it. What's inside the PSD is a whole bunch of different things. And you might notice that the ACPI stuff is one little box down here and maybe a little bit of this box. But all this other stuff really has nothing to do with ACPI. It does other things that configure the system for you and generally make things work. The ACPI is really a very small part of what the PSD does. We are currently at version 3.23.09. It's pretty stable and reliable. Very few problems with it. However, as new systems come up, we do discover various things, mainly because the vendors change their BIOS and things don't quite work as well as they used to. Things that I've introduced recently, there is an experimental switch called NoACPI. What this switch does is it turns off that little box that I just pointed to earlier. And it just basically doesn't turn on the ACPI functions in your system. What this does is it may help some systems continue providing what they call legacy services that get turned off when ACPI is enabled. Some of these things might be your special function keys, you know, various things like that. However, beware that if you do use this switch, using this switch makes your system unsupported. So if you open a ticket and you're using the switch, you'll be required to remove this switch and retest before you can get support. There is no guarantee your system will work if you use this switch, and in fact, in many cases, it won't. Talking about BIOS defects, most of the changes to the PSD have been to accommodate things that the BIOS just gets wrong because, well, they just get it wrong. So it can now handle more of those situations. And I'm constantly implementing the new ACPI CA updates from Intel, basically keeping up with Intel. I believe Lewis mentioned this in his presentation earlier. But that's pretty much all that's been going on with the PSD and the ACPI project lately. It's just keeping up with things, making things continue working, and handling new events as they show up. The other major project has been the Multimac project. And these are old slides as well, but I'll kind of quickly go through them. Multimac is, of course, is just a framework and a library for porting network drivers to OS2. It's not for writing drivers originally. It just is for porting stuff. We originally had a driver that was, we originally had a library that allowed porting drivers from Linux. that didn't work out so well, so that was abandoned, and now we have a library that allows us to port FreeBSD drivers. That works a lot better because the FreeBSD driver architecture is more similar to OS2 than the Linux architecture is. And this is kind of where the Multimac stuff fits in to the picture. It is essentially a combination of the FreeBS driver, which is compiled pretty much unmodified, and then the library that I work on. Those two things combined together make a Multimac driver. Lots of new drivers have been built, and you can always find them at this URL. It is essentially the Multimac wiki page on the ArcaOS website. It lists all the drivers that are available and the chips they support. Every time I release a new set of drivers, I've always checked the FreeBSD sources to make sure there's no updates, and if there are, I implement them. And they basically incorporate system library updates, which is the little interface box I showed you earlier. The things that have happened recently with Multimac are I fixed up some of the many memory management functions. This has to do a lot with SMP issues and just handling memory a little bit better. A lot of the Multimac drivers use a lot of memory. So the better I can handle that, the better it is for everyone. There was a problem. One of the things that is different between OS2 and the FreeBSD drivers is their network stack and the way they handle packet transmission and packet reception. And because of this little difference, there was a little hole where you could get a deadlock in certain very high traffic situations, and this all network traffic would stop. That did get fixed in this in the latest release. There were interrupt handler improvements. Interrupt handling is another way that FreeBSD is different than OS2. So what I did is I implemented a few more ways that the OS2 system libraries can be compatible with the FreeBSD drivers. The other thing I did is I fixed up the intermodule dynamic linking. What this means is the way that the FreeBSD drivers call routines in other modules is rather complex, and I actually implemented their method because this is needed for some of the more complicated network drivers. So that's what's been going on with Multimac. Wireless drivers, of course, is still on the horizon. Not a lot of work has been done on this recently because of other more important things. Although that thing I just talked about, the better intermodule dynamic linking, that is necessary for the wireless drivers because they are complicated drivers that have a lot of intermodule calling. And that was one of the reasons that was implemented. It is about 90, the first wireless driver that is going to be released is the Intel wireless driver. It is about 90% built. In other words, it's almost done, but it's not the whole package because the XWLAN interface still needs to be written. So the total project completion is about 40% for this. Anyway, it is still on the horizon, and I wanted to include it in my presentation just to let everyone know it is still being worked on and still projected to be completed eventually. USB. This is something that's been taking a lot of my time recently. Not necessarily the version 11 drivers, because they are pretty stable and reliable. The recent changes that were made in version 17 are keyboard auto repeat was fixed. It now should work for everybody. And bandwidth calculation issues. This had to do with certain high performance keyboards. Would not work because they required more bandwidth and there was errors in the bandwidth calculation. So that's all been fixed, and that they're all pretty stable and reliable. However, not much more work is being done on the version 11 drivers because version 12 is on the horizon. They exist now. They are 32-bit drivers. Pretty much all of them are 32-bit drivers now. There's only a few that are not yet. It will contain support for USB 3. The USB 3, the XHDI driver, does exist now. It doesn't fully function yet, although I expect to have that working. And to the testers within the next week or so. So we should be seeing USB 3 support coming on the horizon fairly soon. I expect there to be some problems and there still to be work on it. So I don't expect an official production release for that for a few more weeks at least. The 32-bit drivers are significantly different than the 16-bit drivers. They execute faster. Their code execution is faster. That doesn't mean that the USB speed is faster. Obviously, that's limited by the hardware, but the code executes faster because when you're running 32-bit code, you have less instructions. The code actually moves more data per instruction, so they do run a little bit faster. Large sections of these drivers have been completely rewritten. The memory management features, obviously, the device detection routines, PCI bus configuration routines, memory manager stuff, resource manager stuff, these are all brand new in these 32-bit drivers. So there's a lot of stuff that's different, a lot of bugs I found that got fixed just by porting the code. They do have better memory management. High memory is used a lot whenever possible. So they're just better overall. They do have better, faster inter-driver communication, basically 32-bit flat direct calls. So things just operate a little more streamlined, just better overall. Display driver. You will be seeing you will be seeing the 32-bit version 12 USB stack coming along fairly soon, probably within a few weeks or so. Display drivers also had some work done on it. Version 1.11 is the current version. And it had just a minor change to fix the rare compatibility problem with certain BIOS. Once again, we see these weird BIOS defects that come up, and we fix the problems in them. The other thing that got changed in version 1.11 is the screen object. Has new settings to be able to set some of the custom resolution features, and I removed one of the unused pages, the monitor page, which actually had invalid information on it. It wasn't even used by Panorama, so I just got rid of it. Let's see. That's about it with Panorama, other than just to mention that we really still only support custom resolutions for the ATOM and the Intel BIOS. NVIDIA and Matrox BIOSes don't work for custom resolutions. You get whatever you get in the BIOS. Snap. A little bit's been done on Snap. Basically, this information is still the same as my last presentation. The first release was just getting the code to build and install. The SMP issues in Snap have been fixed. The MTRR issues and fixes have been implemented. It now uses the PSD to do the MTRR fixes. Basically, Snap is a collection of drivers, a lot of different drivers, very much the way UniAud is a collection of audio drivers. Snap is a collection of video drivers. If your particular hardware is supported, then you get an accelerated driver. If your particular hardware is not supported, you get the standard Visa driver, which is essentially equivalent to Panorama, only not as fast. But work is continuing in Snap, and as things get implemented and fixed, there will be new releases. The AHCI driver also has had some work done on it, among fixing some of the interrupt issues, which happened in earlier versions. I recently fixed the IOCTL interface so that the smart utilities work again. And because of some of the other BIOS limitations that were talked about earlier, I also removed some of the startup restrictions, mainly because the AHCI driver is capable of running with MSI interrupts. And if it does use an MSI interrupt, then some of the startup restrictions that previously were implemented are no longer valid. So you'll find it can operate in more situations that it was not able to operate in previously. By the way, I can hear you guys there. So if anybody has questions, I probably will be able to hear you if you just shout them out. No work has been done on A-Mouse. It still is at version 3.1.2. It still has the scrolling issue, but it's pretty stable and reliable. I use it on pretty much every system. JFS has no work done on it recently. It still has that version 1.9.7. It's pretty stable and reliable. It still has the very rare check disk issues, but that's the only known problems with it right now. I know Lewis mentioned SoundDriver in his presentation, and yes, there is a new SoundDriver in the works to replace UniAud. However, he mentioned it does not exist. It actually does exist. It is built and is partially tested. It does load. It does initialize the hardware. It does find the hardware. However, I'm marking it as only 75% complete because it needs an entire section built, and the section that it needs built is the interface to the MMOS2 portion of OS2. So although the driver is built and works, it has no way of communicating to OS2 at this point. So that section still needs to be written, and when that's done, then it will be available for people to start trying. As I mentioned, UniAud is really not in development anymore. It's provided as is. It works pretty well for the hardware that it does work on. But it is what it is, and it's still available. I heard some people talking about DOS sessions, and I wanted to briefly talk a little bit about DOS session problems. Be aware that there is not one single DOS session issue. There are actually several different problems, and each problem has its own characteristics, and each problem affects each system differently. Just because you have a DOS session issue or a full screen session issue does not mean that your problem is the same as somebody else's problem, or that what makes it work on your system will make it work on somebody else's system. There are several different issues, and each one is different, and each one has a different workaround or may have a different workaround and causes its own things. For example, I heard someone mention something about max CPU equals 1. Well, that is only one of the several issues, and while it may work on one system, it does not mean it will work on somebody else's system. So no, making that an easy workaround to do is not a good idea, because just because it works for one person does not mean it will work for another person. One of the things that we have come up with is something called a VIOP driver. This is a DOS session driver that kind of works around a BIOS problem. It works in a very, very limited number of ThinkPads. And if you have a ThinkPad and you have one of these DOS session issues, you can open a ticket and we can let you try this driver. It may work, it may not. There is no support for this driver. Either it works or it doesn't. If it works, great, and it helps you fix one of the problems in your system, great. If it doesn't work, well, that's too bad. There's no support for it, and there's no development work going on it. It is what it is. We are also looking into the VSVGA driver. We have somebody looking into this. It is where we believe most of the DOS session issues live. So hopefully once we can get work on this and delve deep into where the problems are, we can try and fix some of these. Needless to say, working on DOS sessions is not the easiest thing in the world to do. So it is time-consuming and requires people that kind of really know what they're doing to work on this. But that is in the works, and I wanted to mention it to let people know that, yes, We do know that these DOS sessions are issues, and we're trying to work around them as best we can. Other stuff, there is something called a test log program. A lot of people already know what this is, but if you don't, it is a way of providing the developers with a comprehensive log of your system in the state it was in when a problem occurred. It captures all kinds of stuff about your system, which tells us pretty much what's going on and helps us identify what a problem was. It has received many enhancements and many upgrades, so make sure you always use the latest version. The wiki pages show you where to get this, and pretty much all of the wiki pages have a link to where to get the latest version. Beware that when you run the test log program, it clears all the debug buffers. So if you run it once just to see if it works, and then you run it again to actually capture the log that you upload, well, most of the data that it was supposed to capture didn't get captured because it got cleared when you ran it the first time. So beware of that. Once you run it, you need to just upload that log or reboot, reproduce the problem, and run it again. And beware that you always want to capture log files in the system configuration that causes your problem and when the problem actually exists. So if you had a problem where, oh, your network locked up, and what you did is you rebooted your system and ran the test log and then uploaded that, well, it didn't capture the problem because you rebooted and the problem didn't exist anymore. You need to try and capture the log in the worst possible state, if you can, when the problem is actually existing, because this test log program is capable of capturing internal driver state and internal kernel state and various things like that, and it can really help us find problems. So what if you have problems? Well, the first thing is read the docs, the readmes, the wiki pages especially. See if there's already a solution to your problem and what you might need to do to fix it or help with things. If you do need to open a ticket, please read the best practices page in the support wiki, because that will tell you a lot about how to prepare the proper logs, where to get the logs, what to do to help us find the problem the easiest for you. Remember, there's not a lot of us developers, so we're all really stretched thin for time, so the most that you can do to help is appreciated. Anyway, that's about the limit of my prepared statements. However, I'm willing to take some questions if people have some questions.
You mentioned the WLAN will be an Intel driver. Will that cover all Intel chipsets?
Yes, I did. It covers a whole lot of them, yes. It's a pretty comprehensive Wi-Fi driver for the Intel chipsets.
Oh, that's great.
What is the estimated time for the driver? I assume you
for a wireless driver?
Wireless, yes.
I don't have an estimated time. We have to prioritize the work that we do, and a lot of more important things tend to come up. My latest priority has been USB 3, and that's going to be the next thing that comes out. And after that, we need to, the ArcaOS guys, we need to get together and have a discussion as to whether audio is going to be next or Wi-Fi is going to be next or whatever. Okay? All right. Well, everybody have a good day.